on the phone, but I'm on music at 10 o'clock. I said, oh, my God.
Looks like they're home sometimes too. It would. Hey, hey.
Good morning. It's good to see you this morning. If you're a guest, we say thank you for being here. We have a couple of guests. We have Dr. Bill Miller and his daughter, Garen, come this morning, and we're glad to have you guys here. And this has been a busy week. Said goodbye to one of our members yesterday and their family, and so free to stay where you are. You slip to your knee, you remain in your seat, but let's invite God to be in this place today. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you for who you are. You would fill this building, fill our lives, fill our hearts. We've come today to do nothing but just to call on your name and thank you for who you are. Thank you for what you do, what you're going to do. I thank you for last Sunday, how you showed up among us, and I ask you, Lord, just do it again, because we're nothing without you. If someone's here that doesn't know you in a personal way, may today be the day that they call on your name and discover not only eternal life in the hereafter, I need thee, oh, I need thee, every hour I need thee, oh, bless me now, my Savior, I come to thee. Let's sing that again, stand. I need thee.
will be hymn number 96 if you're following along in your notes. Seated. It's good to have Brother Bill Miller with us this morning. Brother Bill, would you lead us in prayer, please, sir?
Father, we are We thank you, O God, for the privilege that we have to come to worship you in spirit and truth. And I pray thee, O God, that as we continue to turn to you through song and prayer and giving and the preaching of the word, that you would pour your spirit out in this place. Thank you, Holy God, that your word says where two or more are gathered together, that you're there, God. We thank you for being here today, and we worship you. And pray, God, that you would speak into our hearts and lives, that we would hear from you afresh, and God, bless, we pray, and we thank you and love you and adore you. In the name of Jesus, I pray, amen and amen.
Thank you, Brother Jerry. We're going to do a scripture here.
I'll get there. As you know, we are quoting scripture. We have a scripture in every service, and a surprise for you that you'll see a little later. Would you read this with me? It is good to give thanks to the Lord, to sing praise to your name most high, to declare your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night. Let's stand and read that one more time. This is Can't believe it's the last Sunday before Thanksgiving and 2021, but it is. In this proclamation, he alluded to the ongoing civil war as civil strife. He referenced those who are suffering losses as a result of the conflict, and he appealed to heal the wounds of our nation. In that same declaration, he established Thanksgiving. We're going to put the declaration on the screen as I read it to you. It reads like this. I wish I could do voices because I can hear him in my head, President Lincoln, reading this. For the last Thursday of November next, as a day of thanksgiving and praise to our beneficent Father who dwelleth in the heavens. And I recommend to them that while offering up the ascriptions justly due to him for such singular deliverances and blessings, that they also with humble penitence for our national perverseness and disobedience Almighty hand to heal the wounds of the nation and to restore it as may be, as soon as may be consistent with the divine purposes to the full enjoyment of peace, harmony, tranquility, and union. Before I begin this message, I'm going to let the cat out of the bag. I wish and I pray daily for a statesman to step center stage in our country and lead us in this way once again. By the way, he set it up for the last Thursday in 1941, the Congress set it to the fourth Thursday. Here's what I want to say to you is that it seems that at every turn, at every hand, at every problem, at every mishap, every time that we become giving thanks is never a waste of time. During this month, we've read that scripture many times together, Psalm 92, 1 and 2. And when I prayed through it and sought out that scripture to be our monthly scripture, I never thought that this message on this day, my last message in November, thanks to the Lord, to sing praise to your name, Most High, declare your faithful love in the morning and your faithfulness at night. Let me pray for us. Heavenly Father, for the moments that remain, I pray that you will open your word to our hearts. I pray that you will give us thankful hearts and grateful hearts. I pray that if there's someone here that doesn't know you and they're struggling with their gratefulness and their graciousness, I pray that today that you will bring light into the dark places in life where no life exists. Speak to our hearts now in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. I'm just going to let that stay there just for a second. Because you see, when I read this text, to me, it seems like it's almost a formula for a thankful life. So I'm going to ask you, for goodness sakes, if you answer in the negative, don't answer out loud. Are you really a thankful person? Admittedly, we live difficult days. Almost 2 years now, we have battled this thing called COVID. We have watched even this week as we're reminded of our society that is denigrating, disintegrating. And then you just have the normal struggles. Here's what I will tell you. Life is tough. I called a preacher one time and I said, "How you doing, Roger?" And he said, "Life's hard and then you die." Paul had it right when he warned us about these days. He wrote to his young preacher, Timothy, and this is what he said. He said, "But know this, hard ungrateful, unholy, unloving, irreconcilable, slanderers, without self-control, hello, brutal, without the love for what is good, traitors, reckless, conceited, are you tired of it yet? Lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. Holding to the form of godliness, but denying its power. And then he gives Timothy a warning. He said, man, you need to avoid these people. It seems to me that, generally speaking, when I read that, it says, we'll come in the last days. It seems to me, generally speaking, that we are living in that day, in the last day. We are living, now you'd be offended if you'd like, we are living in a culture and a society that is ungrateful, unthankful, and even unloving. When I look at this list, it reminds me of the overriding attitude of entitlement. And when we have an attitude of entitlement, we find ourselves ungrateful. That our God offers us an answer. That our God offers us an answer. Almost 50 years ago, Andre Crouch had it right when he wrote the song, Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him, there is no other. Jesus is the way. Paul had it right. Excuse me, Peter had it right in Acts chapter 4. He's on arrest. He's in arrest. Under arrest for healing a guy, for doing something good. He's under arrest, and he's countering these people, and he says, here's what you need to know. There is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to people by which we must be saved. Paul writes to us from, he writes to the church of Philippi and by extension to us, and he says, here's what I want you to do. Rejoice in the Lord always. Give thanks in everything. Now, are we really a thankful people? People ask me about being here with you, and I'm done. Here's what I want to say to you. Here's your message. You see it up there. It's good. It's good to give thanks. It's good. It's good. And I want to break it down into two thoughts. First of all, I want you to see our opportunity. Our opportunity. You see, the truth is that we have an opportunity to give thanks. It's a good thing. Now, you like good things, don't you? It's a good thing. It's a good thing, Beth. It's a good thing, Jason. It's a good thing, Sherman. We like good things. Man, we get married. That's a good thing. We have our first child. That's a good thing. Then we have our next child. Well, no, I'm not going to go there. It's a good thing, folks. We get our first job. We have our first paycheck. We buy our first house. We have our first car. Those are good things, and you know why they're good things? It's because they very rarely, when we really see things as good, we don't keep them to ourselves. We show them, we share them, we tell them about the good things that are happening to us. So let's look at here about the good things of the Scripture. Watch three things. It's good. First, in chapter 92, verse 1, he says, it's a good thing to give thanks. It's a good thing. In the Depression, they were raised during the Second World War. To not have enough clothes. They knew what it was to just get by. And so when we came along, and I was the oldest, and they had to learn on me, when we came along, if we weren't grateful, they'd take it away from us, Susan. And then we became grateful. The truth is that we can give thanks here today for what we have here today. Hello? We have much. I'm thankful for the lessons Mom and Dad taught me. I'm thankful for how they impressed me with that. To be thankful, to be grateful, even to be gracious. You won't be gracious if you're not thankful. I think of everything Mom and Dad gave me, and I am so thankful for it. But listen to me. What Mom and Dad did for me, and what this world's done for me, what this church has done for me, those things that I'm thankful for, they pale in comparison to what my Lord Jesus did for me. If I'm thankful only, if I were to try to explain that, to give thanks to the Lord, I don't know how to start, and I don't know how to finish. We'd be here all day into the service tonight. But let me just tell you, I'm thankful for who he is, what he's done, and what he's going to do. Can I just tell you that? Would you just let me unpack that? I'm thankful for who he is. He is the one. He's the one that spoke it into being. I don't know who heard it. I don't know who responded. I don't know how it came together. I believe in the big boom theory. God said it, and boom, it happened. You see, he put it all together. He gives us air to breathe. He cleans the air that we breathe. He gives us a life to live. He gives us everything. And look, and he loves us. He loves us. He knows us, and he loves us. I don't know if anybody besides me thinks that's a miracle, but I do. But not just who he is. How about what he's done? You know, he created us. He put us on earth, and we made bad decisions. Our first man and first woman made bad decisions. Now we're fallen creatures. And we've been broken in relationship and fellowship with him. But here's what he's done. He made a way. Time is stuff. We don't sin anymore. Well, let me just tell you something. If there happens to be one person, there always is one person in our building. If there happens to be one person that you think you're not a sinner, let me just help you here. Ask your wife, your spouse, ask your kids, ask some of your friends. They'll be glad to burst your bubble. Hello? You see, the truth is we are sinners by nature and choice. And I'm just going to say this to you. Your family, they know you. But they don't know the half of it. In fact, I'm going to suggest this to you just to kind of bring us down off our big perch. If your family knew you like God knew you and all the bad things in your life, you might be in trouble. You see, God knows us like we are, and he loves us so much, watch this, that he sent Jesus. He sent Jesus, his one and only son. When we were dead in trespasses and sin, when we were unlovely, he sent Jesus. What a reason to be thankful. Because Jesus is your miracle. He dying on the cross is your miracle. It gives you life from death. So, who he is? He is everything. He's the creator, sustainer. What has he done? He sent Jesus to make a way for us to come back to him. What's he going to do? Salvation the next time He comes to call us home. It's a good thing to give thanks to the Lord for who He is. We can stop right there, but for what He's done, but for what He's going to do. Now, folks, He made a way for us to know Him personally. But it's not automatic. Just because you got your bottom. And I will give you rest. I will give you rest.
Oh, I don't need rest, Brother Jerry.
Well, here's what I'm telling you. The rest Jesus is talking about is this. Let me explain it this way. If you're trying to be good enough, if you're trying to live for Christ all on your own, you will wear yourself out. You'll become discouraged and despondent, and you'll become burdened. Because the truth is, you can't do it on your own. Oh, you can live a life where people call you good. Of our sins, when we choose to follow Him, things are different because the Holy Spirit of God is sent by Jesus Himself to come into your life. Now listen, I don't want you to miss this. Come into your life and take over. He does not come in to take part. It's all or nothing. And when He comes in, man, you got something to really be thankful for. You see, giving thanks is the outflow of the inflow from the downflow that leads to the upflow. Whew. That's giving thanks. Saved, thankful, filled up, spilled out, and overflowing. It's a good thing to give thanks to the Lord. It's a good thing to sing praise. Hello? It's a good thing to sing praise.
Why sing, Brother Jerry? I can't sing.
Let me just say it. This is not about your voice. It's about your heart. It's about your heart. It's not about the sound. It's about your soul. When we are filled up, it's about what spills out. In the 60s, I was a kid. And she's running across. And you know it.
The hills are alive with the sound of music, with songs they have sung for a thousand years. The hills fill my heart with the sound of music. My heart to sing every song it hears.
That lyric right there is what praise is all about. My heart wants to sing every song it hears. I remember the 60s when we began to sing this. Debbie, we may have sang it. Susan, we may have sang it when I was here. The hills are alive with the sound of Jesus. Singing songs that's been sung for 1,000 years.
The hills fill my heart with the sound of Jesus, and my heart wants to sing every song it hears. That is singing His praise. It should come from deep within us. It should flow out of us. It should be our thanksgiving to God. Paul wrote it this way. He says, for the ministry, I'm going to tell you, when you're walking with Jesus, He'll fill you to overflow. The other day, Brother Eric and I were talking about this message and this song and this scripture. And I wonder sometimes when I know that the praise comes from deep, it doesn't come from here, it comes from here. And I wonder sometimes when we gather for corporate worship, when I see during the time we're trying to sing and offer thanksgiving and praise to the Father, I see the verses in there. And I wonder, where's the praise? Where's the thanksgiving? Where's the gratitude? Where's the appreciation for the one who has changed your life? I'll tell you this, we see story after story where firemen go into burning buildings and bring people out, and they never forget, and they never feel like they can say thank you enough. May I just say this to us? We were in a burning building on our way to a burning eternity, and Jesus stepped in, and He pulled us out if we know Him. It's a reason to be thankful today. It's good to sing praise. It's good to give thanks. And number three, it's good to declare His love. To declare love, His love. Human love, are you listening? I got to thinking about this. Human love comes and goes. It's hot today, cold tomorrow. It happens today and it goes away tomorrow. It's kind of like the college freshman boys. Little boy came in this day, it's only second semester, talking to his buddies, and he said, guys, I have met the one. I'm in love. This is the one. And one of the guys in the corner said, again? You see, the truth is, God's love's not like that. It's not hit or miss or up and down, in or out. His love's not on action or commitment. It's based on unconditionality. He loves. Conquer the world. It will show it. Now, I know the scripture, mine says to declare your faithful love. Some say loving kindness, steadfast love. Don't quibble over words. Catch the concept. Share God's love. It's good to give thanks. It's good to sing praise. It's good to declare His love. This is our opportunity. Are you listening? It's our opportunity to impact this world. In fact, one of the things, I see Bill sitting over here, so my mind goes there. Back on the back table, there's a little sign-up list. I got an email from Mark. We're an experienced in Columbia. We have a prayer tent each weekend. We're going to take December the 3rd. And this is quickly, not just an opportunity. I want you to see our objective. When I read this, there are some objectives here. You know, the objective is how we do what we do. You know, why we do what we do. What is our objectives? I'm going to give you three words that when I read these scriptures, they jump out at me. The first word is dependable. Dependable. When I read verse 2 and 3 where it says to declare your faithful love in the morning, feel like it, not just when we want to, but all the time. Be committed to all the time. We need to be, I could use the word committed. I like the word dependable. We need to be able to be counted on. Can you be counted on for the Lord's work? Can you be counted on? Let's start. Let's start at something very simple. Can you be counted on to be in the Lord's house of the Lord's people, reading and studying God's word on Sundays? Can you be counted on to be there Wednesday nights? Hello, we still have service. It starts at 6:30 on Wednesday nights. You're invited. Can we be counted on when ministry opportunities come before us? Can we be counted on when we walk through our daily lives and we encounter people who obviously need a word or a touch from Christ? Can we be counted on to offer that? That's what dependable is all about. Ladies and men in this day, work. I'll tell you what, you're advantage of those opportunities, but our objective is that God sees us as dependable. The second word I lift out of here is devoted. Devoted, it's a first cousin. I will tell you the truth, we're devoted to a number of things. Prayerfully, hopefully. Brother Sherman and I were talking about it this morning. My heart was encouraged last week as we talked about what our Isaac was, what our false god was, and to see people coming and putting to death false gods that we worship. Listen, we didn't choose those because we really wanted to abandon God. Those false gods, those idols in our lives have a way of slipping up in our lives, taking control before we know it. With renewed devotion, where do I get? We really show who we're devoted to. Man, I like my new car. Boy, I like my new gun. Yeah, I like my new bow and arrow. Boy, my team won, for crying out loud. I mean, we give thanks for all kinds of things. Do we just give thanks for him because we're devoted to him? The last word is the word determined. That we become determined. To be determined is to be singularly focused. As we read our text, we discover that the writer, while he likely had other things to be thankful for, he pinpointed this. He was determined. It's a good thing. Thanks, not just give thanks in general, but to give thanks to the Lord, the object. To sing praise to your name, Most High. have him present in our lives. That means at some point in our life that we come face to face with him and we choose him instead of them. That means we come face to face with him and we repent of our sins, which means literally we turn from our sin and turn to him. Turn your eyes upon Jesus, look full in his wonderful face, and the things of the world will grow strangely dim in the light of his glory and grace. You see, coming to Jesus is 180 degrees. That's what repentance is, turning from this way to this. It's not hanging. Most country people in this room know that the last thing you want to do on a farm is straddle something because it hurts. Have you invited Christ not just to make you feel better, but have you invited Christ into your life to change you from the inside out? He stands there with his hands up. Just as surely as his hands are open to this country, his hand is open to you. And he wants to do for you what nobody else can do. And you know what he'll do? Then you'll say, you know what, brother, your scripture is right. It is good to give thanks. And it's sing. And here's the question before you today. Are you thankful? Are you grateful? Because you see, if you're not in the family of God, everything else will distract you. You'll do everything you can do to have to keep from having to deal with this one thing. Are you a child of the King? Have you been born again? Is Jesus living in your life every day? Heavenly Father, you know our hearts. And you know whether we are really thankful or not. I pray that, Lord, that you will deal with us in this matter of thanksgiving as you deal with us through our and their spirit and their heart and their song. I pray that today that you will restore it, that you will deal with them where they are in a loving way and bring them back to yourself. Whatever you need to do, Lord, we're here for you. We're here to listen and respond. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to stand and sing that song that we sang just before I preached to give thanks. The best way you can give thanks today is to respond to the call of God. I'll be down front. The altar will be open. Feel free to come and just get before the Lord, as we said last week. And if you can't kneel, come and just sit on the front row. Have a time with the Lord. Then you can return. If you want me to pray with you, I will. If you've never trusted Christ, I'll be here to talk with you. Let's stand, let's sing, and you come.
Give thanks. To the Holy One, give thanks. cause he's given, Jesus Christ, his Son. And now let the weak say, I am strong. Let the poor say, I am rich, because of what the Lord has done for us. Give thanks.
School comes next. I just want to remind you of two or three things, if I may. Bring it. If you'll be there a little early so the crew can get it set up, we'll appreciate it. Start at eating at 5, and then we'll have the service at 6. Brother Zach Smith from, this is a joint service. Brother Zach Smith will be preaching. Our group will be leading the worship. Brother Kevin from Kokomo will be reading scripture. And you pray. You continue to pray for Brother Glenn. He's healing from his surgery. I think he's doing well. My reports are that. So that's today. We have service Tuesday night at 6:30 this week. We'll probably, I kind of left it up. What did y'all decide? Weren't you, Courtney, weren't you and I the ones talking about that? What did y'all decide? Everybody's coming in. That's what's my understanding, is that we'll be in here for prayer time on Tuesday night, and then certainly we'll have nothing on Wednesday night. We're just taking Wednesday night, move it to Tuesday. Next Sunday, we have a missionary to speak for us as we begin our Thanksgiving. On the back table, a couple of sign-up lists, the Joyful Hearts from the association. We have that's December, Bill, 9? 9, is that right? And it's up at Goss, so the information's back there. And then December the 3rd, we'll be doing the prayer tent. A lot of things going on. I want to... did I miss anything, Beth, I needed to mention? Church office, well, I'm going to be off Thursday and Friday. Y'all call Beth if you know. I'm kidding. No. Office closed Thursday and Friday. You would know that, okay? God bless you. Let's stand in what we're singing. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Let's stand and you will be dismissed.
Praise the Lord.